be aware that LoRaWAN satellite was standardized in November 2020. Not many people know that. So we have 2 years of POCs and trials. And now the key message is it's real. We switch from dreams to reality. And you will see that more than that, it's not only a techno push. We solve problems that the market has. And satellite is a strategic piece to connect the dots to move to pervasive coverage. And I will let you guys introduce you. Maybe I can ask you.
Thank you.
I will not ask you to run.
Very much appreciate that. Thank you, Remi. So my name is Rob Spurrett. I'm the co-founders of Lacuna Space. We were founded back in 2017. Myself and a partner set off on this task of how can we solve the problem of connectivity. It seemed to be, to us, to be one of the biggest problems facing the IoT industry, and satellite was the obvious way to do it. Perhaps what wasn't quite so obvious was how long and how difficult that was going to be, but thankfully here we are, some 5 years later, with actual real paying customers. So it's here now and ready to use.
Telemaco.
Yes. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Telemaco Melia. I'm general manager for EchoStar Mobile. EchoStar Mobile is a European satellite operator. We offer mobile satellite services as core business, and we've been recently launching services for IoT, space that we knew that with standard big satellite terminals we couldn't really get to. So we are now, after 18 months, essentially live with coverage across Europe and working through our corporate offices in the US also to expand and explore new geographies as well.
Thank you. Luke?
Yes. Hello, everyone. So I'm Luc Perard from Eutelsat. So for those who don't know, Eutelsat, it's a French company. It's one of the world's largest satellite operators. We've been around 45 years. We do $1.2 billion of revenue. And on top of our traditional business that has been around, let's say, broadcasting, video broadcasting, as well as connectivity, more like broadband connectivity, we are investing in narrowband connectivity, so connectivity for objects and assets. And I am leading this this portfolio of services that we are delivering for IoT. And one of our first offerings is basically how we can extend LoRaWAN networks via satellite by leveraging the very same technology with a new satellite infrastructure that will enable the same devices to be able to connect anywhere globally at a price point that is compatible with the LoRaWAN price point.
Thank you, and you will understand why Actility is there during the presentation with Alper.
Yeah, without having anything flying in space. My name is Alper Yegin. I'm the VP of Advanced Technology Development in Actility, also the chair of the technical committee and vice chair of the board in the LoRa Alliance. Actility is a founding member of the LoRa Alliance. Our core business is building a core network, both for public and private LPWAN networks. And more than 50 public operators are running on our platform called ThinkPark and numerous enterprise networks as well. And in this panel, I'll be explaining how we're also in the business of interconnecting networks, both terrestrially and satellite as well.
Thank you. So we have a 30-minute slot. It will be split into roughly 20 minutes presentation and discussion. It's going to be a hybrid format, and we will take your question like in 10 minutes. So let me set the scene of this satellite business. Up to now, we can say we are happy, right? We had LoRaWAN networks have entered the growth curve. Diversity of business model brings a value to the market. It's not a question today. And we have a sustainable ecosystem. Let me give you some key figures. 170 public operators in like 100 countries, thousands of private networks in 200 countries. Just one community network like Helium have deployed 1 million gateways in 180 countries over a year. And we don't know when it will stop. And so we may say we are happy, right? But Houston, we have a problem. They cover this terrestrial network, do not cover more than 90, so cover only, 10% of the globe surface. So we have an issue of 90% of the globe surface. Networks are mainly deployed in urban or suburban areas where the business is today. But we saw growing market needs, and we will develop on that, on the remaining 90% of the globe surface. And satellite is able to cover 100% of the globe surface. Okay, mostly with outdoor use cases. It will not be deep indoor. But they really solve a problem that terrestrial networks do not solve. I will never say that satellite will replace terrestrial network. I just say that they can be complementary to serve the market. Looking at what are we talking about? So people are talking about massive IoT satellites, but what does it mean? I don't want to get into technical details, but basically you have two paradigms. The business before LoRaWAN satellite emerged, it was mainly based on two types of setup. The gateway backhaul, I deploy my terrestrial gateway, connect my devices, and look for an IP backhaul through satellite. It's a legacy business. That's more than 20, 30 years that we see that on the market. And every player is able to do that. The limitation is the range of the gateway, but you can use, let's say, standardized terrestrial format devices. It has a limitation of range, of course. The second type of setup is connecting devices directly to satellites. In that case, what we've been seeing on the market, these are proprietary setup. Every satellite company set up an IP, but the issue is that you have to get a customized hardware, a customized network, and battery consumption and bomb cost are not compatible with massive IoT. But the world has changed recently. The new paradigm is to use the same standard for terrestrial and satellite networks. In a way that you leverage your investment as a solution provider, you build your terrestrial device and you use the same devices, except maybe an antenna design and a software update, and you can connect to satellites. You massify, you scale your business. It's the promise that LoRaWAN satellite is bringing to the market. It's based on roaming, seamless roaming between terrestrial and satellite networks. You use native LoRaWAN devices and you connect direct to satellites. And you don't need any gateway. So for some use cases, it's valuable. The type of satellite you are using depends on your use cases and your setup. You may use low orbit satellites, 500 kilometers away from the Earth, in average. You may use middle orbit satellites, more 1 to 10,000 kilometers from the Earth, or geostationary satellite at 36 kilometers away from the Earth. Depending on the solution, you will have some specificities, but you have the choice with LoRaWAN, and you will see that. Let's pause a little bit, and maybe Telemaco, EchoStar Mobile set up a geostationary satellite with a pan-European coverage. Can you maybe develop a little bit on the characteristic of the geostationary setup? and why you chose LoRaWAN instead of Intel?
Sure. So let me start from the end of your question, why we picked LoRaWAN. It was a matter of availability and development of the ecosystem. Availability, we have been checking on how we could lower the cost of running a technology over satellite, and LoRaWAN has proved to be a very viable option, especially with the LR1120. So that was a no-brainer. We've been benchmarking different options, obviously. And again, it's not, we're not ruling out any options in the future. It was just a matter of what's available right now that we got. And second, the fact that LoRaWAN has been recognized by the ITU as a standard, as a global standard, that obviously encourages us to say we are entering into an ecosystem which effectively has legs. Because at the end, what you want to do is go somewhere where the end application, people understand the end application, can develop on top. Selling only connectivity and a modem is probably not the right way to approach the problems. Now, if you look at why geostationary, well, obviously EchoStar is operating a fleet of geostationary satellites across the world, and the one over in Europe, EchoStar 2.1, is providing coverage across the North Sea, Mediterranean Sea, and 27 member states in the UK. So the goal there was really how we can build a service that has capacity across boundaries, which was one of the key questions that people always asked: how we can get 100% coverage. So that's the perfect answer. So if you look at some of the key characteristics that we can offer today, thanks to the geostationary satellite, is real time. So the satellite is fixed in the sky and is giving you coverage and it doesn't move. So real time is one unique selling point, and then is bidirectional. So we believe that IoT has a value if you can get actionable data, and the fact that you can collect data, in our opinion, is half of the job. The remaining half of the job is, can they really take actions and eventually send commands down to the ground? And the last thing that I would highlight is probably efficiency and capacity. It usually has very powerful satellites, and you can reduce the footprint of the device with very efficient antennas, and therefore you are close to what people in the terrestrial market see today. Because what you don't want to do is create two large antennas, two large devices that people wouldn't know how to really handle it.
Okay, very clear. And you start with Europe?
Yes, so today we have Europe obviously available today. We launched coverage June 15th. As I said in my talk yesterday, people can come through and ask to subscribe to our testing program. We will be very happy to do so. And then we have, a global leader in the S-band, which is a specific narrowband spectrum. We are working on business cases to enable also in other regions.
Okay, thank you. So Rob, Lacuna Space, run another round. You chose to deploy the low orbit satellite instead of having one satellite covering one geography, let's say 24 hours a day. It's another concept where you add up to, can be thousands of satellites, increasing capacity moving forward. So can you expand on this second type of setup that many players are using also?
Certainly. So, really we were piggybacking on one of the huge trends in the industry, which is that it was becoming cheaper and easier and quicker to get satellites into low Earth orbits. I'm sure you've all heard and seen of the many great plans there are for constellations of low Earth orbits that are happening. And all of that is really being enabled by cheaper, easier access to those particular orbits. So that's all well and good to get satellites up there, but if you're trying to do what we're doing, which was establish an entirely new price point for IoT, that's only half of the equation. The other half of the equation is, how can you get the cost of the devices down? How can you get it so that you are working at an entirely different cost point for satellite? Historic satellite has been a sort of, I guess a system of last resort. If you've got no other connectivity, you can go to satellite. How can we actually get it to the point where we can do IoT connectivity at prices comparable to terrestrial IoT? So from our point of view, LEO satellites was a key part of that, but the other part was LoRa and LoRa-based devices, because there was a ready ecosystem of devices, chips, and a protocol out there all ready to be used. Why did we need to go and invent stuff that was, you know, more difficult or proprietary? In our view, the way of making it all work was to try and make the system work in a way that it was as common to terrestrial IoT, as common to the biggest standard of the time. And for us, that was LoRa, and that was the obvious direction to go.
Thanks. Maybe Luke, Eutelsat also chose the route of the LEO satellites. End user may experience some latencies. So latencies has become a political topic, and people mix some notions, and maybe you want to develop on that. So what's the real trade-off, in fact, for end users?
Yeah, that's a good question, and people always ask questions about, yeah, how many satellites you have, etc. My answer is, does that really matter for you? Because at the end of the day, when you are using LEO satellites, they are close to the Earth, they are orbiting, let's say, 14 times per day around the planet. And in the way that we are set up with Rob, with Lacuna, and with ourselves, we are not launching, let's say, hundreds or thousands of satellites to permanently add a satellite in space, because there are high costs associated with that, and that would mean a high price for the service. Instead, we are going with a smaller number of satellites that delivers, let's say, a level of service that is highly acceptable, or that is perfectly acceptable for most IoT use cases. That's right, there are some use cases that require real-time communications, that's for sure. With LEO and with our approach, we are not serving those use cases. But the good thing is that there are actually a potential of several dozens or hundreds of millions of devices that don't need real time, and that's sending small amount of data, and where, as a matter of fact, even they only send data, they don't necessarily send requires the way back to send command to the device. So the impact of the number of satellites is, let's say, how many times per day me as a device on the ground do I see a satellite, and do I have the opportunity to send the data? So when you start small, you have a small number of opportunities, 2, 3, 5 times per day. When you launch more satellites, you will have more opportunities. Our plan is to basically have a satellite passing over every 30 minutes. That's actually covering, from our studies, that's sort of covering the majority of use cases. Because when you dig further, most of the use cases, they don't need real-time capabilities. What is important to you is to be able to connect those sensors, no matter where they are, those sensors that operate on battery, etc., that need to last for years, that are anywhere in the world, and be capable of sending that message at a price point that makes sense. And that's exactly the challenge we are solving with this.
Thank you. Thanks. So we understand that there is no winning setup. It depends on your use cases, it depends on your setup and your geographies, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
And at the end of the day, what do we want to achieve? Which problem do we solve with satellites? We can talk hours about the technical setup, but what problem do we solve? So there are a lot of discussion around satellites. Let's think that for the ESG stakes of humanity, satellite will play a key role for sure, because the problem we have to solve are not in the center of Paris, right, necessarily. I will take three drivers. for the use case of satellites. First, all about linear infrastructure. Can be poles, can be a railway infrastructure over a country, can be pipeline, everything that is beyond the range of a gateway or multiple gateway or just one farm in Argentina that is as big as France. The second criteria is obviously remote areas where it's not cost effective to deploy terrestrial network. And I would say the last and very important market is the international business. We all think about logistics. So all the use cases that you have here are part of these three drivers and shows that there is a huge potential. So maybe I have one question for you. What type of use case do you intend or do you see coming on the market, maybe starting with Rob?
So one of the amazing things about satellite IoT is just the amount of use cases and the variety of them. Every time we think that we've heard of every single possibility, we get a new inquiry with something completely different than we hadn't thought of before. And I think that that's kind of one of the things that's driven our approach, which is to be very much a connectivity provider to solutions providers out there, so that they develop the knowledge for this huge range of possibilities that are there. We can't possibly gain the knowledge we need to service all of those. So we very much are focusing on the connectivity so that we can then work with specialists in each of these different areas because there are just so many of them. We can't possibly begin to understand them all. And if we work with many, many solution providers, then we can get the scale up and we can get the cost down. So I think my simple answer is that there isn't one particular specialization. Satellites provide possibilities in all of these areas, and we've got to find ways of addressing them.
Okay.
Yes. So I speak by experience, because we've been launching our testing program a couple of months ago, and to date we've been onboarding, or we are onboarding, about 17 partners already. So I'm just extracting from what we've been seeing, so it's not any particular personal thought, it's really what we see coming from the market. So we have a few partners that are really looking at monitoring critical infrastructure, and they split between railway and utilities. Railway, for instance, is a very interesting problem to solve when you do sidetrack monitoring, for instance, because you don't have only the connectivity problem, you also have all the mechanical issues of deploying in this type of environments. Utilities, there are a lot of power units monitoring in the field. That's one thing. We see a lot coming up in the whole smart farming and agrotech. People needing, obviously, to deploy turnkey solution without going to the farmer to actually ask him to install a BTS with DSL to bring back the data to the cloud. Logistic and tracking. All the LoRa users have been telling us, yeah, we'd like to do that, but we don't have connectivity between different countries. Or we do, but then the roaming piece is very complicated. So clearly there they have an advantage because it's a single network, and then it's a peace of mind for them. And then there is all sort of non-standard use cases where they need remote connectivity because deploying networks is not really cost effective. We have people in the Wi-Fi, for instance, fire detection, people that need to track assets across Europe. So all these different, very specific use cases that, it's hard to generalize, but all of them have in common with the fact that they need to work.
Okay, thank you for this comprehensive explanation, Luc.
Yes, well, just like Telemaco, I will mention actual customer needs that we are addressing with our partners. So we have one of our partners here who is exhibiting WAN networks, for instance. They are actually swamped by needs for connectivity for agriculture. Because let's be honest, doing smart agriculture, if you cannot connect sensors that are in the field in rural area, well, you don't do smart agriculture. And suddenly, when you can have low-cost sensor that can run for years on battery and that can be deployed in rural area and that at a price point that makes sense, suddenly you really open up that vertical, that application. So a lot of smart agriculture, a lot in Latin America as an example, big area for agriculture, we see a lot of traction for this. We have the same in Africa as well. In South Africa, as an example, we have a customer, let's say, the first customer who is already let's say designing their soil moisture and temperature sensor based on this solution. So that's really let's say a key vertical that we see here, really satellite unlocking that application. But just like the others have said, all those industries where you don't necessarily have moving assets, but you have assets spread out everywhere. Oil and gas, linear infrastructure, you mentioned this. It is difficult, or it is impossible to actually connect them via terrestrial networks. Some will be connected via terrestrial networks, but some of them will not. It depends on the use case. Sometimes it's maybe 5% that will be outside of terrestrial network. For some other, it might be 30%. So that is why, actually, we are partnering with companies who do deploy terrestrial networks, and we extend their networks via satellite in order to enable them to deliver this ubiquitous connectivity that is needed for those industries in utilities, in oil and gas, etc. So that's, in a nutshell, utilities, energy, oil and gas, and agriculture are really big. And I will not mention logistics and assets, because that's more or less the very obvious one, because by nature, those assets that move, they move in and out of coverage. So they typically have coverage maybe in ports, etc., via terrestrial networks. But as soon as they go out, there is a lack of coverage. And of course, that's also a use case where we see good traction. But I wanted to highlight those other ones that it's not necessarily the ones that come top of mind because they are fixed use cases.
I think it's a good transition. Alper, Actility is not basically a satellite company. And what we explained, remember, slide 2, that the paradigm change here is that it's not only starting a new business for satellites, we do not reproduce what has been happening for 40 years. We combine the power of terrestrial network and satellite network. Actility has set up one of the largest, if not the largest, roaming hub in the world since market change. And you connected this net two worlds. You maybe want to explain.
Right, thank you. Thank you, Remi. So I'd like to start by mentioning two of the fundamental differentiating features of LoRaWAN. One is the low cost, both for the radio gateways and the core network. The other one is the use of unlicensed band. Because of these two features, the technology has been so accessible to the point that people have been deploying LoRaWAN at home, in buildings, and then building nationwide, citywide networks, and also now planet-wide networks. So we've been seeing organic growth all across the planet. Now, that's in a way similar to what we have been seeing with Wi-Fi, but unlike Wi-Fi, we have another very fundamental feature, which is collaboration. We have a very collaborative LoRaWAN ecosystem in terms of players wanting to work with each other. And also in the technical community, we have built a very reliable and easy to use way of integrating networks. So on one side, the networks are mushrooming around the world. On the other side, we have the ability to integrate and unite them so that they can present themselves as a single network to the end user, to the use case, which has been badly lacking with Wi-Fi, as you are all aware of, right? So because we have taken this as one of our objectives from the get-go, we've been able to integrate networks first on a terrestrial basis. And for that, we built a platform called ThinkPark Exchange. It's a peering hub that enables easy interconnect across all sorts of networks. So today we have more than 30 networks connected to this platform. Half of them are public LoRaWAN operators. And then we have private networks, we have community networks like Helium as well. And we also have satellite networks connected to this platform like Kineis, Lacuna, and now we're working on integrating Eutelsat. And we have a few more in the pipeline. And like Luke explained, these connectivities are very complementary. You can certainly have significant amount of coverage with the satellites, except for the indoor case. But even when you have an outdoor case, the customer would like to leverage their terrestrial network whenever it's available, and then fall back to the satellite one in case of much more challenging cases. So we've been integrating the satellite networks as well, so that depending on the use case, the customers can access their own private network, and then when they walk out of private network coverage, leverage the public network, and then when they're well outside the public network coverage, they can be leveraging the satellite coverage. And we've been demonstrating that at our booth, so feel free to stop by. And yeah, that's what we've been, so we've been on a mission to keep integrating as these networks emerge. So thanks to the partners here, now we have a very good chance of having a planet-wide coverage, and maybe next year we can talk about beyond the planet.
Thank you, Alper. So we are on the top of the hour, but we started 5 minutes late. We are entering the break, so we are happy to take some questions. If you want to ask questions, please go to the mic, that we can hear you.
Just to explain, it's now, we're now into the break, but if you want to stay a little bit longer and then ask the questions, then please do, go for it. That's great. So come up to the mic if you have a question.
You dare not.
Yes, good afternoon. Just a question, because do you see any need to adapt on the security aspect? Because I listened to your presentation earlier on security, because of the fact that it's using satellites, so with a longer time to reach the network servers. So would there be any need to make a modification?
Thank you, Ron. So starting with this Friday's meeting, we have the technical committee meeting on Friday, so contributors, sponsors, and institution members are very welcome to attend. Now we're going to start discussing LoRaWAN over satellites. So with the contributions from Eutelsat and EchoStar, we'll start the conversation to get to know their experience with LoRaWAN over satellite and if you need to tweak anything. So that conversation is starting. And it has already started in the regulatory working group with respect to the regulations. And you'll start seeing more so in the TC as well. I'm not aware of any security elements yet, but I wouldn't be surprised if something pops up there, and we'll be discussing it as well. Thanks for the question.
Thank you. Another question?
Hi, Don Miller here from Trackershare. We're in the container tracking space. Just a couple of questions on business model. The typical tracking that's been deployed in maritime industry has really been focused around cellular up to date. And I think on the business model side, it's usually a hardware component pricing-wise and then a software or services component price-wise per month or per day or whatever they end up using. What models do you see for this if you were going to tackle a marine application or a logistics application that would be able to match the kind of solution? Because I know we're talking about satellite messages, and of course, over the road, that's a well-understood business, which in trucking, they charge a lot more. Up to $30 a month for satellite solutions is common. But when it comes to larger applications, like in containers that go international, which is really what I think this has a huge advantage for, maybe to Luke, what do you see as some of the business models that might exist for this?
Yeah, well, let's say the thing is that with satellite networks, you have some finite capacity of the network itself. So we need to make sure that, let's say, we are offering a price point that will allow to sustain our business. At the end of the day, satellite, as Remi said, it's going to be more expensive than terrestrial networks. That's a fact. We are not competing with that. We are extending that. But let's say our model, in terms of commercial model, because you're asking, is actually very partner friendly. We ourselves, we are not proposing connectivity service in itself. We are leveraging partners who are blending various, let's say, their own network capabilities with satellites, so enhancing or OEMing the satellite piece into their own offerings, whether they are offering just connectivity or whether they are offering solutions themselves. So here, our pricing model is very, let's say, very flexible, very partner-friendly in a way that it's not necessarily tied by device, and it's not necessarily tied at the end of the day by message. We can be very flexible because we realize that, as I said, we are in a partner business. We need to enable the partners to be capable of addressing their use cases. So here, welcome to hear more for the various use cases. We have some initial ideas, as you may have heard, in terms of how we go to market, and as you mentioned, on a per message basis. But we can be quite flexible in order to enable the variety of use cases across the various industries that make sense for their business. We're very open to, yeah, to work with partners like this in
there. Thanks very much. And the last question, because obviously we look at this pole-to-pole coverage, which certainly it's an exciting metric. However, you know, if I'm looking at international marine transport, shipping lines who would deploy this would not necessarily, they don't care about the vessel because they own the vessel. They know the containers are on the ship. I think there is an advantage, of course, when containers are top deck, that you can have a signal come out from the top deck when it sees the sky. But that's not always the case, especially with a large amount of dry containers. There's a lot of ways that can be solved if you do an entire fleet where one unit can report and knows how many units are on that ship and they can kind of report. I mean, aside from mesh or anything else, it can be done even through software. But I guess the real question is, the gaps that we see in the market are largely first mile and last mile, no different than the challenges that cellular has. So when I talk about the panel and the business model, we need to also think, if cellular has these gaps and these issues and we're solving that, what is the metric of increase that pushes that ROI to get the deployment done? Because in the end, that's the end, that's the win. Right now in trailer tracking, it's highly competitive and the prices are higher. I think this solution will work really well. But once you start getting to containers where the volume of transit of the boxes is much less, it's only 4 turns of a fleet per year, whereas trucks are on the road almost every day, the metric needs to change and we just need to think about those models.
Thank you. Very good. Thank you. Any more question? No question? So impressed by the audience and many people interested in satellite. That's a good sign. That's what we are talking is not just a dream. Just to recall that LoRaWAN satellite is real. That could be the conclusion. Of course, you will be happy to reach out to the LoRa Alliance members that we are here on the panel. They are ready to start real business. The heavy lifting and the homework has been done for the last 2 years. And I would say that 2022 will be the year of the satellite new dimension, combining Alper also the power of this terrestrial network. We will have a panel on the network business model diversity. We do think that this business model diversity, including satellite as a key piece, is a key factor of success for the future of IoT. IoT is going to be massive, but not only. IoT is going to be pervasive. And back to the ESG stake, if we do not solve this pervasiveness, probably IoT will not scale. So that's the reason why, again, guys, the world is yours. And thank you very much.